Hi, I'm Harry. Welcome to another SUPboarder video. In this video, we take a tour around the Red Paddle Co HQ, and we found it super interesting. There's loads of really good points in it. So this is a bit of a warning up front that this is slightly longer than normal video. It's about 40 minutes long, but I really hope you find it as interesting as we did, and I hope you enjoy the video.
Okay, so we're here at Red Paddle Co HQ, International HQ in South Devon, UK. We're going to have a look around. The guys have invited us in. We're going to see what their range is like. We're going to ask them some questions. We've got some reader questions for them. Generally just going to ask them everything about paddleboarding to help you guys understand what this brand is all about.
Yeah, and behind the scenes. Because behind this grey door, your world will change. You haven't been in yet, Harry, so you won't know this, but I know it's pretty cool. Ready?
Look at this.
Awesome to see this all this stuff.
Hello!
And here is the man himself.
Welcome.
Mr. Red.
Virtual handshakes all around.
and so great to see you here in your home.
Well, yeah, I don't actually sleep here.
No, yeah. I spend a lot of time here with the amount of
new developments and boards and stuff. And
it's just, it's great to be here and experience this massive Red warehouse, basically. Well, it's more than a warehouse, the showroom.
So is this where everything happens?
Yeah, so this is what we call International, Red International.
Yep. So do you want to give us a quick run through of the new 2021 stuff?
Yeah, sure. I mean, there's loads of stuff online, but you might not want to go through every detail. But
this is our October launch that we've just launched. There's a few, you probably pick up on a few boards, March launch boards are not fully on display yet. But yeah, so we've got the ranges, as probably people know it already, so starting at end, just because that's where the boards start. We've got compact boards, 11 foot, the 9.6 compact boards have been extremely popular.
Yeah.
And we're trying to, kind of push on what an inflatable board can do, as far as, not just on the water, but packability, storability, transportability. And then there's the ride boards, which is our, our biggest selling product.
And these are the boards you started with. How old are the ride now?
Ride in name is, probably 10 years old. Yeah. And in shape, it's, all the time, but things like our new twin fin system, which come from learning on the compact boards. We use it a little bit, I suppose a little bit like Formula One would use, they test stuff at race level and it filters down. And actually, I'm not sure that actually does happen, but it definitely happens in our world, So our most premium product, the compact, we learn a lot from designing in there, and we go, actually, that twin fin works really well. We should use that in the other board. So that's how that's evolved, basically. Obviously, our flat bungee system, our new cargo system, which we're really excited about, because we spent years lacing up boards with bits of bungee, shoelace bungee, and it's a bit of a...
There's obviously quite a lot of thought behind this.
Yeah, it's a fair bit of thought,
Because to me, it just looks like a flat bit of bungee.
Yeah, it doesn't use any clips. There's no clips involved, so it's self-tensioning, it grips on friction, it doesn't come off. You can obviously... And the good thing is, it does use the standard D-ring style, so you can adapt it.
So it's not, I think it looks, aesthetically, it looks really good, but it's not just purely for aesthetics.
No,
you've done it for a purpose.
I think of it like a roof rack. So if you think you're loading your kit on, you boys are windsurfers, when you go and put your windsurf kit or your paddleboard kit onto the roof of your car, you don't lace it up.
That's right.
You go one strap over there, one strap over the back, and tension it, and that's enough. And you drive them over 80 miles an hour. So having all this laced up bungee, which I don't have a board here, it's got it, but it's kind of, in my mind, defeats the simplicity of having those two straps. So I know you wouldn't use the pump on the front, but it's the nearest thing over to hand. But when you're paddling, you want to be able to grab stuff and put stuff down. You put that on, it's just held in place because it's being pulled easily, perfectly down. And you can sort of get to stuff. You have to lift three bits of bungee up and get, it's simple. So it's not just done for aesthetics. It's done for a reason.
Well, you might as well talk about that now, John. Actually, the beast.
So this is a new Titan. My initial thought was this is something from Transformers. It looks like it's a robot. It's amazing.
Yeah. it's been fully thought about. So I guess most people, hopefully a lot of people, know what a Titan One or Titan Pump was, which are a double chamber pump. We've been there, we started off with paddleboards with massive fat chambers and you could barely get past 12 psi and the performance on the water was horrible and you break your back trying to pump your board up. So then we made we were the first to do it, a single, thinner, single chamber pump, a bit taller, so took a little bit longer to pump the board up, but it was a lot less effort, so yeah, heart rate was lower, and eventually had a bit more energy left of paddling, but it was a time issue. I mean, that's the thing about pumping, it's a pure matter of physics. It's time versus volume, or time versus effort, sorry.
Yep.
So ultimately, we then put two chambers together and that works. Loads of volume, it gets too difficult, you need to switch off one of them and just run on the small one. It's a two-stage pump. It's not like we reinvented the wheel there, you know, it's been around for a long time in all kinds of pumps, but we're just trying to make one that was applicable to paddleboarding, you know, so it matched the volumes and the ability.
Are these the same size chambers as last year's, or the previous
time? Diameter, yeah, yes, slightly taller.
Slightly taller.
So the time one worked really well anyway, and so actually the physics side of it is very hard to make it much more efficient because it's still that time versus effort thing. So we can make it easier, but that makes it longer to pump a board up, or we can make it quicker, but it makes it harder. So what we tried to really focus on with the Titan 2 was efficiency of air. So making sure the air was feeding through the various gaskets and non-return valves in the most efficient way possible. The things like that used to annoy us as much as anybody else is, you know, when you screw a hose onto a pump, very hard to get a good seal there. You know, if the pumps fall over, you get threads get gnarled up, or you get sand stuck in them. So now we've got that bayonet fitting that you're familiar with for the board end, is now on both ends.
Oh, right. So oh, cool.
You put that in, and it doesn't matter which way around you go, it works. It's also got a massive big gasket seal there, so that holds it in. You know, we've kept the exhaust valve captive, so it's not pulling the plug out anymore. And ultimately just trying to get that feed of air through the air box, which is the air box, as most efficient as possible. So basic stuff like the hose is now connected here rather than here, so it's not going up and down and floating around.
Yeah.
It stays in one place and we make it slightly shorter. The shorter you make the hose, the more efficient it is.
Yeah. Straight away you can see that there's been some thought
into
that.
A lot of thought in that.
Yeah. And why you guys, you know, there's a lot of pumps. Well, there's not that many pumps out there on the market, really.
No.
You guys have chosen to make your own pump.
Yeah.
A lot of other brands are just using OEM products. Yeah. Why did you do that?
Well, it's kind of from day one. We didn't really want to use an existing product. We didn't use someone else's product. But it's a point of difference. We wanted the added value to the product.
Yeah.
And we want to understand our product, and we want to know that it's built right, because it's built correctly, using the right materials, by the right people, in the right conditions, and all those other things. You don't know that stuff unless you build it yourself, design and build it. So, and there's lots of things that frustrate us about other designs that you can't change, they're not yours. So, you know, for example, even our own thing, you know, we'd go, better next time. So we need to lubricate the pump, or you need to replace a gasket or a non-return valve, because ultimately this is a mechanical piece of kit. It needs maintenance, you know, it's not going to last like that forever. So now you can quickly get to those gaskets without getting your hands messy inside with the O-rings and things. It's all maintainable, and it's designed for disassembly, which is our big thing, is that every single part on this pump, because again we own the molds and we do it, you can replace it. So it's not like it's broken, chuck it away. You could keep this pump going for basically an indefinite period by buying or getting provided with very, very small parts, which normally you go, nah, it's broken. You try and find parts for some of those other pumps, they're not available. So and also things like the packs down smaller, so you fold those handles to have that, fold the feet in, and now rolls, the board rolls are much neater, more simple roll, which is just nicer and easier to pack our own transport.
That's probably some of the compact stuff is probably sort of led to that, because that's the way that you work on the compact.
And I think your point about why don't we use anybody else's products, because we don't need to. We built the company so that we can design our own products. It's not, we are, as you're about to find out, you know, a serious business. You know, we are based near the coast, we paddleboard, we do our own thing. You know, we're not directed by the rest of the manufacturing industries or what we can get our hands on. If we want to make it, we make it. You know, want to use it, we make it.
And always, I mean, the finishing off, I've always said it with all the reviews, the finishing off on Red is always higher than anybody else.
And you can talk to Phil about that if you want.
He will
give you that insight, that knowledge of how we achieve
that. For example, I'll just say one thing. Is like usually when you get a paddleboard review, and I would say it's acceptable, you will have a slight glue mark around the outside and maybe in the back of the deck pad, and it's sort of thing, you know, it's okay, you'd accept it, especially at the price points that some of the boards are coming out at. But with Red, you don't get any of that. It's like perfect out of the box. And I'm not just saying that from sanity, John. I'm saying that because when I've unrolled them, that's what they're like.
We're just really passionate about what we do. We're not actually about really selling paddleboards. We're about selling that as the best product we can, and we just happen to be, you know, really passionate paddleboarders. So
yeah,
it's the obvious thing to do. So ride boards, and we've got the sport boards, which is kind of your upgrade from a ride board. Really, it's your sort of if you ride your family car, this is your sort of GTI. You know, this is faster paddling. More manoeuvrable step up, but then actually once you go through there, you get up to a real proper touring board, which is the Voyager 32. Actually, I might get this down because sure, it's easier. Obviously, touring, and we all do that. We live in Devon, we live in touring country. You know, it's great for getting up the estuaries and the rivers and the creeks. We just really wanted to make a board that did that the best we could possibly do it. And there's probably over the years, to be honest, the Sport and Voyager range sort of started to get a bit too close in style and use and performance. So we think, okay, let's make it really stand out. So we've been on it for a while, but this has got a V-hole in it, which, you know, there are other V-holes around, and there was not the first one of this kind, but most of the V-holes run front to back. A lot of them do, so it makes it more extremely unstable. But what you really want is to maintain all the brilliance of the Voyager, which is a stable, heavy loading capacity board, but we want to get that a little bit more speed in it. So just by putting a nose V in it, but then also maintaining that rocker line and tapering it, you know, so it's not blunt, it comes out, it tapers all the way back, right up. So
it looks really good, actually.
Yeah.
Like, the pictures don't really do it justice, I would say.
Very hard to get that in a picture, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, and you look at it, you've got some really good shape there. But you mentioned how, because other people have played around with this type of concept, but do they not taper it out?
Some better than others, absolutely. But one thing about making products, anyone watching this would know if they're involved in manufacturing, is it's one thing to do a prototype, make one. Yeah. It's another thing to make 20,000 of those.
Yeah.
You know,
perfect.
So perfect at the same time and replicate it. And actually, I think if you stood up a lot of paddleboards over the years and you got hold of 10 of the same product and you laid them on the floor together, they'd all have slightly different rocker lines and, you know, slightly different shapes and slightly different widths and stuff. We're really constantly trying to get it so it's repeatable. So you're getting the same experience whether you buy a board in Spain or if you buy a board in Peru. You know, it's the same product. So that's a part of that skill, is getting that to work. So a lot of rocker lines is a good way of explaining it. So that scoop on the nose, which is what the rocker is on a board, most brands would do that by either forcing and bending the front of the board and then gluing a strip on the top to hold it in place, or they'll cut the drop stitch material to create that scoop. But what you tend to get is a real Turkish slipper scoop, which is anyone who's paddled with one of those boards knows. You hit chop it, you're stopping at the time that we get headwind and get hit by a side wind. So we've for years done a thing called progressive rocker, where actually the rocker in these boards starts somewhere back here and just slowly increases.
Okay.
So that when you're paddling, the water just almost seamlessly goes under the board. There's no slashing or slapping. And it's minor stuff, but we sweat the small stuff. You know, we sweat that kind of performance. And so the V-hole is very much like that. It's tapered off. The rocker, so you've got a very complex curve. So you've got a V-hole there, and it's got a scoop as well.
Yeah.
If you're trying to get that so it's consistent and smooth, it's quite difficult. So we do it by cutting the drop strip stitch on the top in a certain way. A certain degree of almost like a wedge at the top to create that V-hole, but
and that's why you get the concave
on the deck,
which could be an advantage in some respects for load carrying.
That's the V-hole, and then on the sport we also have the twin fin system as well. So again, learning from what we said from the combat from the ride boards. So you can retrofit this with whatever fins you want, but you can get really small on the fins and still get great trackability when you're paddling, but you can get through real short, you know, shallow creeks. But also when you're loading it on the beach or on the riverbank, we've all done that. You've got your board there, pumped up, ready to go. And at least I've got a fin that's difficult to tell, but when it's a single fin, it rocks from side to side.
Yeah.
You're potentially damaging your fin, the fin box.
Which is actually one of the key reasons if I'm doing touring, I'll carry a spare fin.
Yeah.
But actually this takes away the need to do
so
that.
So this now sits flat because it's got equal weight, so you can load that up all with your kit and it's not going to fall over. So it's, you know, that comes from us being paddlers, I suppose, and using it and listening to customers, listening to people that we paddle with and experiencing ourselves. So.
Well, one question I did have on this that came from a reader actually was, why doesn't this board have the edge release and kick tail the other
stomp
ones
pad.
Have? Yeah, the stomp pad.
I think we've done it at the stomp pad because ideally, ultimately, one, it's a long way back and down that board anyway, and if you've got gear in it on the back, what's the point?
Yeah.
It doesn't have the release on the back because they're a bit much more pinny in the tail anyway. So that red release works well when you've got a big sucky fat tail that's being sucked down to the water's edge. These are much thinner in the tail, so they definitely don't feel like they really needed them. And that's another thing about more stuck into the water, that V-hole when you paddle it. If you paddle a flat nose board, it feels like it's being sucked, the nose being sucked down. Yeah. You don't really notice it until you get on one that doesn't do that. And you go, all right, it's actually kind of lifting out the water, so you get a real nice release. Every paddle stroke, you get a little more glide, a little more kind of, a bit more feedback from the board, basically.
So, and I've read that you guys have been doing some work with, I think it's the Coast Lab.
In Plymouth.
Has some of that been related to these innovations?
It's only related to this stuff, yeah. So all of it, so we're, Phil probably won't, but he could blind you with science on all the stats. So we've got readouts from the wave tank on what the V-hull does, what the flat nose does, different widths and lengths and everything. So, you know, we did.
Does that extend to the tail release as well?
Not so easy to do that, because that's a speed thing, isn't it? So
yeah. It's just interesting what you're saying about how the different tails and how that corresponds, because we definitely see it's almost impossible for us to measure the benefit, but you can see benefit. But yeah, when you talk about different tail shapes, it does have a different impact.
Yeah,
that's quite interesting.
Mm. I think the nose of a paddleboard is almost more important than the tail of a paddleboard, which sounds a bit strange to say, but because everybody's nose is engaged in paddling, but not everyone is engaged in the tail. So, like, from surfing, you could have the most amazing tail shape on a surfing sup or a surfboard, but if you don't actually step back and engage those fins and rails, it doesn't matter what shape it is. And so you quite often, back in the windsurfing days, people go, oh, but this fin isn't good enough. Well, you're not forcing it into the water to create, to get the benefit of the performance. But everybody's nose is being engaged. So that's where the V-hog, everybody's nose has got a punch with the chop. Mm. Everybody's, and that's why, again, if you look at our board shapes, stability on a paddleboard doesn't come from behind you, it comes from in front of you. So the wider the front of the board, the more stable it is. So sometimes I see paddleboards are almost like back to front, so they've got narrow noses but fat tails. But actually, it should be the other way around. It should be fatter noses, wider noses. So anyway.
So why don't you have that on the rest of the range?
Which is not really relevant for a lot of the range. So you wouldn't want to go surfing with a V-hull, because it would send you off in all kinds of funny skew whiff patterns down the wave. And so we don't say the Voyager's not a surfboard, but the sport boards are 11-foot, 11-3 board. You're quite happy to jump on a wave and ride that. And even if the nose hits, it's just going to come up again and carry on. Whereas you've got a V-hull, it's going to do something you weren't expecting.
Probably. So the race boards themselves haven't got that, have they?
No. So race boards have a FFC, forward flex control stiffening system on the front. So actually, my experience of racing and having done a fair bit of it, the games in racing are won off the start or off the turn, so stiffness has got to be the most important thing in inflatable. So that forward flex control works in partnership with the RSS bands, which are side bands on the board, and it just keeps a much stiffer forward profile. So at the moment, we haven't worked out, we had to get those two working together, the V-hole and the FFC.
But in an ideal world, they would be.
Probably, yeah, would do. But one is working on compression front to back, and one is, so yeah.
You've got a lot going on.
Forces, so, yeah.
Fantastic. Right, so that's a quick run through most of the range. Shall we get a tour?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Next room on the Grand Tour of the Red Paddle Club building is a Red Original head office, which is normally full of people, but COVID, social distancing, we have to work from home. So Luke heads up Red Original marketing and does all the kind of any kind of promo stuff through the website.
So for those who don't know, can you just give us a bit of a feel about, to explain what Red Original is? Because,
Oh, yeah. Peace camp. So we've been paddleboarders for, 10 years pretty much, but water sports users for a lot longer. When we were paddleboarding, we were finding we were using kit that wasn't quite fit for purpose or wasn't to the quality that we wanted and matched the quality of the board. So we set about launching a range of accessories, so everything you need before, during and after getting on the water, and launched a range of those, so ranging from toweling changing robes to waterproof changing robes, drinks bottles, waterproof deck bags, and everything that you might want when you want to go out on a paddleboarding adventure. And then we quite quickly realised that we were using everything kind of in multiple different sports as well, especially some of our performance clothing, drinks bottles kind of go to your desk with you. So we've actually started to shift our kind of focus away from just being paddleboarding accessories, so it's basically multi-sport accessories now. Yeah, I mean, everything we've designed is for paddleboarding first and foremost, but it's having that kind of that thought that how else can we use this and making sure it has that kind of multi-sport appeal.
Yeah.
We did a survey a while ago, and majority of paddleboarders that we surveyed do between 2 and 5 activities. I think it was 90% between 2 and 5 different other sports.
Yeah.
So it's making sure that we're designing kit that can be used in a whole variety of different settings. So you're kind of reducing the amount of products that people have to purchase as well. So coming from a sustainability and eco kind of point of view, you don't have to buy 5 different waterproof jackets for 5 different activities, just buy one that works really well across all of those.
And James is James is a man of many talents, because we actually brought him in to run our Red Rescue project, which is our life-saving product, which is a prone rescue board, inflatable prone rescue board project, which we started with the RNLI. But obviously COVID, obviously too much rescuing going on. So James has been helping with customer service on Red Original, gets in the warehouse, you know.
So all your customer service, everybody, it all comes to here, to this, nowhere else, it all comes to
English
this.
Language, outside of North America, we have a North American team doing that as well in time zone, but yeah, everything English language is out of here basically, and run 7 days a week. So that's why we'll respond on email on Saturday morning at 11 o'clock when a customer will email us, I'm on Bognor Regis Beach, and I'm not sure if the tide's coming in or going out. That's the kind of question we get asked.
You get that specific question.
And we're like, wow. Okay, we'll have a look. Yes. So, it's coming in. I'm not sure if that's good or not, but anyway. Or they'll be on a beach and asking us a question, or you know, they're sitting on the sofa at night thinking about, oh, which board to buy. They'll email us and we'll respond within minutes. And they go, oh, I wasn't expecting a response until Monday, but that's all done out of here, or we do it from home as well. So, that's Red Original. All the stuff that
banana.
This is the marketing hub for Red Paddle globally. Again, it looks a little bit sparse because we're working from home. I let the team introduce themselves.
I'm Charlie, head of marketing for Red, and oversee all the team and general dog's body, and I look after all the social as well now for all the regions, and then Stu.
Hey, I'm Stu. I'm like the graphic designer, creative guy on the marketing team, look after photo shoots and all sorts of assets and everything. Also owner of Ted, who is asleep in the corner.
It's a dog.
It's a dog. I
just actually realised it was a dog.
Excellent.
Hello, I'm Robin. I'm Red's marketing and communications manager. So I look after our content, our PR teams throughout all of our key markets, and also our global ambassadors program. So yeah, that's us, our core team anyway.
I want to ask perhaps a pokey question, but I think a lot of our readers might say that a Red Paddle Co board is a more expensive product, and they might say it's just because they pump loads into marketing. What would you say if people were saying that? Well, how does that add value to the product that you're getting at the end of the day? I think we've touched on it probably a little bit already, but
I think what we're doing is not just fluff, I would say. So a lot of what we're producing or talking about is actually about education. So it's whether it's about, you know, telling people about where to paddle. So, you know, whenever we've got our places to paddle on our website, or even if we're doing a photo shoot, it would always be around, you know, we'd then produce content from that about, okay, well, here's some nice pretty pictures, but actually here's some practical guides about how to paddle this place. So lots of stuff we do around that. And then, massive other things about education of how to paddle, so paddling techniques. That's, you know, a huge thing we do. And then also about safety as well. And so actually, while we are kind of promoting the brand to a certain extent, actually a lot of it is actually just about helping educate, just in the wider sense about paddleboarding, and you know, all of that, whether you're a Red Paddle Co customer or not, it's out there, you know. So, you know, all of the content on social or on the website, whatever, it's just there free for people, you know, to use. And then also a lot of it is about the product use. So it's actually, once you've bought a board, so how to maintain your board, how to pump up your board, how to, you know, look after it, all of this sort of stuff. You know, we produce a lot of stuff around that as well. And then a large part of what Robin does is around bringing people's stories out there, whether they are, you know, Red Paddle Co. ambassador or just a real person. It's quite a big thing for us, is that actually it's showcasing the different types of people paddling. Like, it's, you know, it's not all about, you know, beautifully honed people in their 20s. You know, that's not paddleboarding. You know, okay, there are those people, but actually, that's, as a brand, we don't ever want to be seen to be being, you know, fluffy or too polished or anything like that. We want to bring out the stories of people overcoming adversity and, you know, whatever.
And you're trying to inspire people, because completely. You know, you're not trying to just paddleboarding is a sport that for you is here for the long term, and you're trying to build that community and show people what you can do on a paddleboard. Completely. Because, you know, over the summer, loads and loads of people have got into paddleboarding, but actually probably don't know what is possible on a paddleboard. So you're trying to create that, and that's kind of a value that we share as well with SUPboarder. We're trying to show people the breadth and how amazing this sport is, and I think you guys are in the same position with that.
Completely, and I think that's, you know, our tagline for how many years, 4 or 5 years, has been explore your world, and that's the crux of it, you know, in a very cheesy way, but it's about your explore your world, and your adventure might be, you know, paddling down and going to the pub and getting out of the pub and having a pint and coming back. But how epic is that? Like, that's awesome, you know. Or it might be paddling down the Yukon, you know, whatever that might be. But I think a lot of people, as you said, in the summer might have got a paddleboard and, you know, be circling around the bay. Great. But what we want to show is actually you can go a little bit further, and that can, you know, still be really achievable. And you don't have to be a fit young guy to do that. You know, there's so many people just doing, you know, awesome things. So yeah, it's a really big part of what we do, is just, you know, show the type of people out there that, you know, paddleboarding is literally for anybody and everybody. And I think a lot of people think that we're this big corporate machine, and, you know, it's an interesting one being on social, you know, looking after all the social channels globally, and actually, you know, when actually it's like, oh, I'm just, you know, I'm here, I'm just sitting at home, it's Sunday morning, and I'm just answering your questions or whatever. So actually, people get that, I think, when they do have interaction with the brand, they realise that we're a bunch of people, and, you know, it's you know, we're just normal, a normal bunch of people. We're not this big corporate giant as such, even though we are professional. And
we've been in it for a long time, we've been doing it for 12, 13 years, you know, so I always think a lot of companies, maybe they feel like, you know, we're bigger, and it's some way artificial that we're bigger. It's not that we've just been at it for a long time. You know, it's a fairly old company. You know, it's been going for, and pre paddleboarding, the company was going in windsurfing for another 25 years. So there's, you know, we've been in this business for a long time. So hence we built out a brilliant team, and it's not a startup anymore.
Yeah.
There's plenty of paddleboard startups. And, you know,
are you the biggest paddleboarding company?
I don't know, it depends how you're measuring it and metrics, but we're definitely one of the most formulated, you know, that's, well, we're focused on making paddleboards, that's all we do, apart from making the accessory side of things. So we're not a kite surfing company or a surfing company, you know, we are doing paddleboards. That's what everyone you see in this building is basically involved in the paddleboard brand. So from that respect, yeah, we probably are one of the more staffed up, supported teams. Hopefully that comes across in not only the product, but the service side as well, so, which to me is just as important as the product. This is an extremely busy office. It actually is, but they're just not here. Obviously, there was a lot of them working from home, but apart from my desk, I sit there and just spin around in circles on my chair doing nothing.
John's the most important man, but he's got the smallest computer.
Everyone always says that.
See, he's got his name on it, just in case he misses out where he's got to sit down.
Because I don't sit at my desk very often, so I quite often just pick that up and I'm off, you know. I can go anywhere. I'm fully mobile. This is actually the operations hub of the company, but again, people working at home, so we're covering, there's Helen, sorry, by the way. Helen is, she actually makes everything happen, so she's our finance director, so if we need to pay anybody, do anything, structure the company, it's Helen's magic that does it, basically, so she's like my right-hand man, can you say that? Right-hand
So is this where the decisions are, the price points of the boards come down to, and really why they are the price they are, why? And some people will always say, like, why, like you touched on earlier, well, I can buy a paddleboard from
wherever brand for half the price, and why shouldn't I buy, you know, why should I buy a red? And obviously there's lots of reasons we've gone on to that today, and there probably will be, but...
I think the thing obviously comes down to this point here, you deciding on these price points. And
yeah, the important thing about price is not it's not just the board you're buying. You know, you're buying everything you're seeing. You're buying into the fact that we've researched and we know it can last. We're giving you a 5-year warranty. You've got somebody who's going to answer your email in, you know, minutes rather than hours rather than days. All of that goes to it. You know, it's the whole package. It's from the bag, the pump, the paddle, the experience you're having. The fact that the board actually retains its value and you can sell it for not far off what you paid for it, you know, a year or two down the line. So that's all part of that. It's all built into that, isn't it, in that pricing structure. So.
I know you believe it's still good to have those cheap price point boards, because some people can't afford. Yeah, I'd love, you know, the red sport. It's a beautiful board, isn't it? But some people can't afford. But if they can get into paddleboarding for that cheaper price point, and then they move up, is a red paddleboard.
It's the same in any part of the world, isn't it? Whether it's cameras that you guys are using, you know, you've got the latest Canon, Sony, Nikon, whatever. You can also buy a more basic camera that point and shoot and probably does an okay job to a point. So same as cars, same as bikes. Bikes is probably a good example. So paddleboarding is like the bicycle of the water, in my opinion. So you could go to Halfords or any other chain store and buy a bike, and it's got 21 gears on it, and you could ride it around the park, and you could probably get it up a few hills and probably down a few hills, and it would work fine. But if you wanted to go that extra mile, you want to do that, go there slightly quicker, or have a better experience, or have it not rust after six months of sitting in the shed, you can buy a more expensive bike. But that's cool. There's no pressure, you know, to buy any of those things. So we don't hold a gun to anyone's head to buy our product, obviously. And likewise, nor do the bike brands. So you choose. You make a choice. And yeah. So I think the choice is based on lots of things. But value for money is a huge thing. You know, we've all done it. We've all bought cheap products and gone, I'm going to have to buy another one now because it's broken, it's worn out, or whatever. Or I've tried to get some support or some help with it, and there's no one at the other end of the phone line, or there isn't a phone line. So yeah, I don't think the price is necessary. It's not a straightforward, you say, oh, this is the way you work the prices out. It's not a straightforward calculation, times this, times that, times that, equals this. There's a lot more to it than that. So, you know, we're not just building a price list.
Yeah.
You know, we're building an honourable company with good, great product and great service. So it's all built into that. Anyway.
There's a lot of...
Okay. Really quiet. This is a letter spotted George Shillito in his enclosure.
Oh, yeah.
We don't like to... disrupt him too much because he gets quite angry.
Is he listening to R&B or is he on the phone? He's on a Skype call.
I think he's talking to his mum. George is our commercial director, so George has been with the company for quite a long time, comes from a windsurfing and paddleboard background as well, running centres. So I think a lot of us have been involved in either retail or coaching. So we've kind of trod a path that helps us understand the market, understand the people, understand the customers. So, but yeah, George heads up the commercial side, making sure everyone's happy and distributes happy. That's one of our meeting rooms. So, yeah, we have to have four high meeting rooms so we can get bored then. Otherwise, you can't have a meeting about a board if you can't get the board in the room with you.
We can only do the compact today.
Yeah. Exactly, rolled up.
Quasar.
Christ. Here we go.
Interesting stuff.
This is Phil. Who heads up our design and production side of business. There's normally other people in here, but that's the same as I keep saying myself. There's lots of,
how many people have you usually got behind this team?
Three in here. We did have four. We had placement students in here, so we haven't got one at the moment. So anything with a red logo on it starts in here.
So how does it work then? If you're designing a new board, if you were a surfer, you would have your shape in the bay, you'd shape it, within 2 days you'd have your board that you'd go out and test. How does that work here when you don't have the manufacturing and I'm assuming you have the small scale, manufacturing?
Yeah, can you produce a paddleboard here? Can you make a paddleboard?
We could make one from scratch, we don't, but because it's actually quicker not to do that.
Yeah.
But what we will do here is first of all, we'll identify the problem, identify the need. What do you need? Do we need to make a new, let's say we're going to make a completely new board. Then we'll sit down with the various people within the team and within the company and potentially customers and retailers and school owners, and they'll tell us what they want, and we'll work out, do we want that? Okay, we decide we want that product to be made. We'll then sit down and go, what does it need to look like? What is it, shape, dimensions? We're very experienced. I've been in the water sports industry since I was mid-teens, and I'm many, many decades past that now. But so I think there's many, many years experience, so we kind of know a little bit of what we want to achieve already. So we'll cut it up, we'll draw it up. We'll do FEA, so finite element analysis. So we'll do
FEA,
like.
Okay. I'm glad you. Yeah.
So let's say we're making a part on a product, and we want to go, how is that going to take strain or load, and we'll put it through the system, the computer systems that we use, to identify areas of weakness or areas of concern, and we'll design around that to improve it. I don't know why I'm telling you this. Phil should be telling you all this. So we'll do that first, and then we can get we'll get the spec off to the team, and they'll make it for us, and we'll get it sent over if it's a board. But what we tend to do, and I don't think we've got one, I've got a few bits here. We'll make blanks, so we'll make a blank board, and then we'll stick stuff on it here. So we'll add fins on it. We'll adjust fin positions. We'll use simple things like Velcro, for example, and stick fins on and put them in different positions and paddle.
Okay,
it,
yeah.
And build it up from there.
Yeah. So you're not just giving the manufacturer whatever a CAD file, say, here we go, stick those on the boards, and yeah, then we'll put them to market.
Or we're not doing what a lot of people would probably do, which is, what have you got that we can have? What have you got that we could use? What fin boxes are available? Oh, we've got A, B, and C. We don't even go there. You know, we've got our version of it, and what we want, and it does what we need it to do. So, and if it breaks, or if there's something wrong with it, it's only us to blame. Nothing worse than trying to blame someone else for a failure or something. They go, it's not my fault.
So I think this is a really good point. I want to bring up double chamber.
Oh yeah.
Okay, this is a really big thing, because we get a lot of boards that are review that have double chamber, and obviously they do make the boards stiffer. They do potentially make the boards safer if you pop the outside or inside one. But I know you guys do not use dual or double, however you want to label the brand name up.
Yeah.
You do not use that. Why do you not do that?
I'm going to attempt to draw this, and Phil will laugh now, because I am the world's worst graphic guy. So you've got a paddleboard.
Oh, I'm really bad.
Just
perfect.
That's pretty good, actually. That's not bad.
It looks a little bit like a whip, mate.
It does.
So that's your paddleboard, inflatable paddleboard. And obviously, when it comes into the factory, it actually comes on a flat sheet. And then you cookie cutter out your board shape in the middle. Okay, so you've got two open-sided. Open-sided shape, so you've got a 3D shape, got stitches inside.
There's a bit there, actually, to show.
Yeah. That is ultimately what, without wood on it, obviously, because it doesn't hold up, but that's what paddleboard material is. It's a flat sheet of this, and a bottom sheet underneath. And obviously, so you have to seal it around the outside. You have to seal the air into the board. I'll go back to my lovely drawing. So you cut your board out from your template, you've then got to stitch seal all the way around the outside, which is your rail tape, as we call it, or seam tape. And then ultimately you want to make sure you've added enough layers to that to hold the air in. And you've got a valve in the board, obviously, where the air goes into. In my mind, the safest possible inflatable paddleboard is the one with the least amount of seams, the least amount of holes cut in it, because that's the least amount of exit points and fail points. So although the theory of a double chamber is good, the practice and the way it's done, generally, in my opinion, is not that safe. To make a double chamber paddleboard, you make it, and then you take a massive big chunk out the middle of it. Basically, you create a donut, mm-hmm. a ring donut, a donut hole. You lift out that material, and then that bit that you've taken out, you then got to seam it up again. And you've got to then seam up the inside. That's inside the board. It's very hard to get in there and probably get a really good seal.
Because at this point, they're still manufacturing those seams by hand.
All hand, yes.
By hand. So you, yeah. And how do you basically do that quickly? It's just heat, or is it just glue and whack it on?
It's heat and pressing and pressure and everything going into it, and lining up the along the template line to get your rocker curve.
So it's very labour, that whole process. Yeah, it's still labour, and it's even more intensive.
And this is really difficult to do, to stick something on the inside. We've all done, haven't you? You piece of sellotape, a bit of sticky tape, you can stick it around the outside of something, but trying to stick it in the inside curve on a convex curve is very difficult. So anyway, you've cut that out, you then seam this up, put another hole in it for a valve, and then you take that out and lift it up and you put it back in the board. Well, you basically just create a huge area of fail all the way around there. So what happens then is the board then might, if it fails, you go, whoa, thank goodness I had a double chamber board, otherwise I would be finished. But actually, if you go back and if you can get your hands on them, I don't know if you will be able to, but if you get hands on statistics on double chamber, all of the fails will be along this seam line. You just designed in a fail point. So in our mind, the best place to avoid a failure is to have no fail points or minimise the fail points. So we make sure we make the board extremely well and extremely tough, and there's multiple layers, and the materials put around, and you get weft and weave of the material, so you've got to make sure you put it along the right axis so it stretches in the right way, doesn't overstretch. A good example, if you took a red, we could do this maybe later downstairs, you deflate a red paddleboard board right down to almost like one PSI, it's almost not registered on a PSI scale, and stood it up downstairs next to a board at 20 PSI, it'd look exactly the same. Because the structure is not coming from the air pressure, the structure is coming from the shape of the board. That's the point why we don't do a double chamber, basically, because we feel they're slightly unsafe. And actually, well then from a performance point of view, it's very, very hard, and you've probably noticed this over the years, that when double chambers first started, they were about this big.
Yeah.
And then they went about this big. And now they're probably about this big.
Yeah.
Because as soon as you cut out the middle of a board, you've completely destroyed the structural integrity of the weave. And so you get boards that are twisted, or boards that have got real crazy scoop rockers, and they get worse as time goes on, because you've just cut the heart out of it. And these will stay together. So not only is it a safety issue, I also think it's a performance issue, and you'll end up getting a board that, and if you've got inner pressure different to outer pressure, and it gets hot, those things happen differently. There's a huge amount of torsional force going through that structure, which again is going to lead to issues and problems, and poor performance.
Yeah, we've definitely covered that in reviews, actually, where we've taken double chamber boards, cheaper price point boards, to be fair, and they have bigger chambers and they do have those twists, and we've highlighted that and said this is the downside, the negative of
that. And that's why you've seen double chambers get smaller and smaller,
and they get smaller and smaller.
They're not actually that useful, because, so let's say your board deflated at sea, the outer bit deflated at sea because that's the bit that's going to fail, which means it's in a sea. You're left with this bodyboard bit of sit on, and actually the rest of it's dragging the water and probably making you drift quicker or something in the tide. So obviously we're big advocates of safety, waist belt PFDs, I know it's one down here. Using the right leash, using the right buoyancy aid is as important, or more important actually, than having a double chamber board. And before you came in, because I knew you were going to ask me this question, I thought I'm going to have a look over the last few years of our critical fail board. So we record everything that goes wrong, possibly wrong with our product. In the last few years, our critical fail within season is 0%. So, kind of to me, highlights the fact you don't need double chambers because the boards don't fail critically.
No.
Everyone makes mistakes from sticking something on a board. Okay, that needs to be sorted out from a service point of view. But we don't. You can take all the graphics off our boards and all the fins, the little twin fins, and the V holes and the RSS bands. The most important thing is making a board that stands the test of time and lasts. And, ultimately doesn't fail.
Yeah.
And that's not to say we're perfect, we're not, everyone makes, has issues, but in the last couple of years, looking at the data, we have a 0% critical fail. So to me, that means you don't need to build a double chamber board, or we don't, and therefore doing that is basically increasing the chances of a critical fail.
So one of the things that a lot of people will be asking us, and every business needs to be doing, is what they're doing to be sustainable, how they're going to protect the environment. Paddleboards, inherently, it's plastic. An inflatable paddleboard is probably even worse. What are you doing? What are you doing to try and help that situation?
Everything that you do, fridges, cars, everything, if you can make that product last as long as possible, that's a good thing, because you're not creating the extra consumer demand. Because the biggest thing that we can do is change our habits through consumerism. Like, eliminate waste.
Yeah.
Try and just, but it's not about plastic is bad. Plastic is not bad. It's the application of plastic that's bad. Ultimately, everything that we make is eventually not going to be used. We need to think about the material, not just the product. It's not the article, it's the substance. So we need to think about what's going to happen next in that material. So if we make the pump, for example, we make that, so all the parts in that, you could literally just, if you bash it or accidents happen, you can literally throw it in the recycler, and that can be completely recovered and it can be reused.
Right.
Now, obviously, before you get to that stage, there's different strategies you can do. So you can do product life extension. So you've got to make product last as long as possible. So if we can sell you a spare to repair,
yeah,
then
we can make that product last a lot longer, which is obviously offsetting the amount of time it needs before it needs to be processed negatively or positively. So yeah. So if you broke the switch on your pump now, what would happen to a lot of pumps now? You've got a pump that you can't use. Mm. That whole pump, all the energy, the shipping, the fact that they had to dig up the materials, the energy that you, all that energy is wasted. Energy, you can't make energy, it just changes form. You've literally got to recover that and make sure it's circular. And that's the, it's called the circular economy. So that's what we're trying to do at our factory. Because we've not contaminated the material, we can easily recover it at source.
Yeah.
So when our material comes in, it comes in a roll or a flake, like a pastry.
Yeah.
Okay. When we use that, we cook a cookie cutter of the material, but because we've not contaminated it with anything else, we can use our suppliers can recover that material more easily, so we can actually make out, so our factory is zero waste.
So the offcuts of your cookie cut can be used.
We can recover those.
Yeah.
It's just at their end of life once we've processed it. So that's the fabrication that we're trying to improve the fabrication.
Thank you very much, John, for giving us a hell of an experience of Red Paddle Co.
Yeah, well, thanks for coming in. Thanks for everyone watching the videos, and hopefully it's useful and insightful, and we're a bunch of real nice people just getting on with what we do. So yeah, thank you very much.
And loving what you do. Let's get out of here and look out for some more Red videos on SUPboarder soon. And we're going to get out and maybe go and enjoy an evening paddle or something, yeah? Well, a bit of sunshine. Cool.
Awesome. Go away now. Go.
Cheers, George.